Os presento brevemente a Alexandra para no quitar demasiado tiempo a su presentación. Pues ella viene desde Grecia, aunque haya tenido su doctorado lo ha hecho en Manchester, y de hecho es una doctora novela, fue el que ha acabado en marzo del 2010. Su tesis de doctorado era sobre la política del género y la migración en los grupos antirracistas de Atenas. Y era ha sido dirigida por Erika Burman, que os acordáis vino el año pasado aquí a darnos la charla en Simbref. En este momento está trabajando como investigadora en la Pantheon University de Atenas y está trabajando en dos proyectos subvencionados por la Comunidad Europea que dirigen a ellas como grupo. Los proyectos son el GEMIC y el MIGNET. Ahora os voy a decir qué quieren decir. GEMIC es Género, Inmigración e Interacciones Interculturales en el Mediterráneo y en la Europa del Sudeste. Y el MIGNET es Redes Digitales Transnacionales de Migración y Género. Como veis, muchas cosas sobre género, redes y migración. Estos proyectos están coordinados por María Stratigacci y ella trabaja conjuntamente como investigadora con otras dos personas que son Nelly Campuri y Dimitris Parsanoglu, más o menos. Entre sus investigadores, sus trabajos, sus publicaciones de investigación de metodología y epistemología, hay dos, una que está específicamente dirigida por una de las traducciones, hoy ya tenemos este problema, pero de las traducciones, como se habla en la investigación, que siempre como investigadoras estamos traduciendo, y que está en el Journal Group Analysis. Y luego tenemos una publicación conjunta que hemos hecho a partir de nuestro doctorado, un poco reflexionando sobre la epistemología y la metodología que hemos utilizado en nuestros respectivos doctorados y un poco haciendo ver aquella trastienda que muchas veces no se hace ver, ¿no? Y todos aquellos fallos que se cometen también. Ya le dejo la palabra. Hoy hablará de la relación entre activismo y investigación. En una primera parte hará una introducción un poco más teórica y epistemológica y después entrará en ejemplos concretos trabajando esto sobre las perspectivas epistemológicas y metodológicas, la interacción entre el activismo y la investigación. Yo acabo aquí y le doy la palabra a Alexandra.
So, my name is Alexandra Zambos, and I'm very, very grateful and very honored to be here and to be invited to your seminar. And I will try to share some of my work with you. And what I will be speaking on draws on my PhD studies, which I have just completed, as Barbara told you, and also research that I've been doing outside the PhD. So I think I will be referring to debates that are already known to you. So my purpose is to actually try and map various resources, mostly developed through feminist approaches, in order to think about the politics of research, the kinds of challenges one faces, and the directions an activist research practice can initiate. My presentation, I have thought to have two main parts, one more, let's say, theoretical and the other more empirical. And I want to be open to use more, the one more or less, depending also on what you would like along the way. So if we find that the kind of theoretical elaborations are too boring, or not boring, but you know, maybe too heavy, we can then shift towards, you know, the more empirical aspects. Okay, to start off with, I think that it's really important to consider that we're always working within an intellectual and philosophical context that may comprise competing paradigms, which can hold political implications for how and what kind of knowledge we produce, what objects we study, how we do research, what this research is for. This means, for example, in very practical terms, that when you are doing a research, a European Commission funded research, and a lot of research now is funded by the European Commission and not by national agencies and national institutions, one of the requirements is that the research is policy relevant. Okay? That means that you have to produce the kinds of data and the kinds of narratives, the kinds of analyses that are assumed or supposed to be relevant for policymakers. This presents a kind of, let's say, limit within which you have to frame your research. You cannot just do whatever it is that you like. And even if you do what you like, in the end, you have to formulate it in a way that will suit this requirement. One of the things that policy-relevant research asks of researchers is to produce quantitative data. In other words, it is assumed that quantitative studies are more representative and can give a better idea of social processes rather than qualitative studies. And that means you have to really try hard, first of all, to defend qualitative research and then to show why qualitative research and why going deeply in one, let's say, particular aspect or one particular case study can actually illuminate more things about social relations and power relations and social struggles than, let's say, doing surveys or questionnaires. So this is what I mean, that the kinds of paradigms that we are, as researchers, called to materialize, to use, are always somehow politically implicated. Working from a feminist approach means, I have titled my opening, let's say, considerations, positioning oneself vis-a-vis feminist genealogies. So when we are working as feminist researchers, we are always in some relation. Oh, okay.
¿Esperate, se ve yo o no?
Sí.
Gracias. Si vuelve a pasar, es que el enchufe es un poco malo. Si vuelve a pasar, me lo...
So, as feminist researchers, we are always positioned, we are always taking a position within feminist genealogies. We're not just working in a uncharted space. And this means that we are at the same time both following a tradition but also challenging or breaking with that tradition. And so, for example, in the 90s, there were huge debates over second and third wave feminism, and which is the better feminism? Is second wave feminism that looks at objective social relations and social inequalities and assumes that all women share the same identity and therefore also the same politics. Is that a better feminism than, let's say, third wave or postmodern feminism, which says that there are no fixed identities and we are shifting and we are situated at these crisscrossing axes of power and there can be no identity politics, we have to look for alliances between different actors, contingent alliances. So there were also debates about Western or third world feminism, where third world, so-called third world feminists challenged Western feminism and said that you are speaking from the position of a white Western woman, which does not reflect my experience and my position in the global hierarchy of power, and therefore I do not recognize you to speak for me. So these kinds of debates have not only theoretical and epistemological differences, but also socio-political implications. Some of these socio-political implications have to do with the academic context itself. For example, can third world feminist scholars work in white Western universities? And if they do, how are they positioned there? Are they positioned as, let's say, the token other who will represent, let's say, a kind of ethnic standpoint? And Nirmal Pubar, whom you have, I think, met in this seminar before, has written a book precisely on this issue called Space Invaders. So these debates and conflicts, which, as I said, have socio-political implications, have been very productive also, in the sense that they have produced new concepts and understandings. For example, around the issue of intersectionality, which we will get into a little bit further. Positioning oneself as a researcher in relation to feminist genealogies is not only an intellectual standpoint, but is also crisscrossed and shaped by the social identifications and power relations in which the researcher is immersed. In other words, the researcher's subjectivity and positionality impact her theoretical epistemological choices. And, for example, as a white researcher, I'm now thinking in relation to the work that I did with migrant women. I can choose to look at migrant women as the object of my study as if I am, let's say, separate from them, or I can choose to look at migrant women as through the relationship that is produced between us. And this relationship entails aspects of power. So if I look at the relationship rather than the other, I'm looking at how my whiteness, whether it marginalizes migrant women, whether it not necessarily intentionally, but my white, unmarked position creates a hierarchy in which, a structural hierarchy, where I am at a different and superior point than migrant women, and it is then the researcher's choice to reflect on this and to also ask the participants, the migrant women, to reflect on it together. And this would take us in the direction of doing activist research. One of the ways that we can understand feminist genealogies is by looking at some of the issues that that have been structuring feminist research. Now, the first, let's say, reflexive moment of feminism started with what is called the crisis of representation, which has to do with the post-structuralist critique of language as a transparent medium of communication. So the crisis of representation basically says that there is no world out there that we can know and represent through our language, but our language and our categories of thought are constructing the world that we are apprehending as reality. Now, this has had a very profound impact on feminist epistemologies, because it has broken the positivist, objectivist science narratives, and it has called for different kind of knowledge production, for situated knowledge production, for co-construction of knowledge, and such issues. In this passage from, let's say, a more objectivist or naturalistic or positivist science to a post-structural, postmodern science, and which to a certain degree coincides with the passage from second to third wave feminism that I mentioned before, there has been a kind of concern or lament, what has been called the passing of feminism. So is feminism losing its object? Is it becoming obsolete? So when one tries to position oneself within these feminist genealogies, one has to somehow address this concern. And another issue that I think is important to think about in the context of this genealogy is, where does the gender concept come from? Because, let's say, in feminist theory, there has been a movement from looking at women and women's exploitation and women's oppression to thinking about gender as a power relation, as a sexualized construct, as a discursively produced category. And gender has become a very, let's say, potent concept in theory and research through which to understand social relations. However, gender itself has its own history, the concept, and its own genealogy. And this is something, again, that we need to be aware of. Because, to give you a specific example, in the Greek language, there is no distinction between sex and gender, right? So, while in the Anglo-Saxon literature, the sex and gender division is theorized on, this is something that the Greek language does not allow. So you have to consider how you're going to represent the, let's say, sex and gender division, dichotomy, or how are you going to account for using gender, taking it from the Anglo-Saxon literature, but how are you going to think about it, use it in a Greek context that doesn't have the same, it doesn't have the same resonance? So this is what I mean by situating the gender concept. You take it from one body of literature, but then you have it in your hands and you have an empirical situation and you want to analyze it, but maybe the tool or the concept needs to be modified in relation to this empirical situation. Well, one of the ways that, but these issues, these are some of the issues that, we're facing as feminist activist researchers. And here the question of reflexivity can actually maybe offer us some ways of addressing these problems. Now, in this PowerPoint, I have gathered a lot of quotes on these questions and topics, and there will be no time to, go through them, but they will be at your disposal, and I think they are interesting and useful resources, and if there's anything around these, any of these that you want to discuss, we can be on email communication or okay. So I will go through as I said, there are a lot of things here that we won't be able to see. Okay, so going on now to reflexivity. The question of reflexivity, that is, of the researchers or the knowers' reflection and impact on the process and on the relations of knowledge production, is not specific to feminist approaches, but it has been taken up by feminists in order to challenge positivist masculinist scientific paradigms and, most importantly, to raise the question of accountability. What are the researchers' intellectual, institutional, and political commitments? How is this knowledge produced? Who is this knowledge produced for? Who does the researcher hold herself accountable to? These questions have epistemological and political significance. On an epistemological level, the break with positivist social science was addressed either from the argument of standpoint theory or of situated knowledge. Both these share a common premise that we are always producing knowledge from a specific position which is not neutral or transcendental. For standpoint theory, this is a social position, the position of the marginalized, and specifically of women as the marginalized, which holds a privileged understanding. This is a very identitarian approach, which has been criticized for its essentialism. The social identity of a subject, their gender or class identity, constitutes them as privileged subjects of knowledge because of their experience of oppression. On the other hand, for situated knowledge, there is no privileged position. What one is looking for is a multiplicity of perspectives. Objectivity is possible only from multiple perspectives. This is a non-essentialist approach. These epistemologies also have their parallels in politics. For example, class politics, leftist politics, are based on identitarian assumptions. Because we are poor or working class or exploited, we should all share a common consciousness, even if we are not aware of it, and a common politics. This is clearly not the case, since people's political commitments are based on a variety of affiliations and investments. On the other hand, we have what is called transversal or alliance politics, which does not look for an axiomatic unity, does not assume a priori commonality, but looks for contingent alliances across different positionings. If we assume that the researcher influences the object of research, how are we, and that we can understand or know this through the practice of reflexivity? How can we practice this reflexivity? What does it mean to be reflexive researchers? Now, the first thing that one needs to consider is that the practice of reflexivity itself rests on certain assumptions. It rests, first of all, on the assumption that there is a subject that reflects, right? There is a consciousness, there is a unity, a unified subject that reflects. So, in a lot of reflexive practice, so to speak, this is the kind of subject that is trying to do the reflection. And this subject is constructed as, let's say, a unit. It has an interiority, it has feelings, it is separate from other people and separate from the objects of research. It can know its feelings, so it has a kind of transparency to itself. And it can separate itself from the others. Now, this is a particular ontology. This is not, to practice reflexivity in this way does not mean that it is the natural way. There is a certain, to understand the subject, in other words, as this self-contained entity, is a particular way of understanding and constructing the subject. And it is actually a normative way. And therefore, it could be interesting for us as researchers to think what the practice of reflexivity would look like, for instance, as critical ontology. In other words, if we assume for a moment a cyborg ontology, or as Haraway said, or what she later on goes on to speak about as companion species, how would a reflexive practice look like? How would it materialize from that kind of ontological position, rather than the ontology of this human subject that is separate from its objects of research and its surroundings. Shall I go on? Okay. Some other ways that we can think of the practice of reflexivity are, the most standard way that reflexivity is practiced, and the most, let's say, problematic way, is practiced in an emotionalized way. So the researcher explores her inner feelings about the object of the research, about the problem she is encountering, tries to understand why this research has a personal meaning for her, and through this, first of all, personalizes the research. In other words, it takes it out of the social kind of relations that she is part of, that produce her as the researcher and somebody else as the object of the research. They take her out of that and make research a kind of, you know, individual project that, So how can we address this? How can we practice reflexivity without falling into this trap of the individual, emotionalized, regulated subject? Now, for instance, some of the answers to this question, for instance, Patty Lather says, my interest is in the limits of reflexivity and the possibilities of non-mastery as an ethical mode. Within, how do we do that? She says, within and against. We practice something within and against. It is about both doing it and troubling it simultaneously. So what she's saying is that we have to occupy a particular position of taking, using something, performing it, and at the same time questioning what it is that we are using or what it is that we are doing. She talks about the practice of failure. So how do you produce a reflexive account that does not obscure the problems, but actually shows all the moments when the researcher, for example, cannot make meaning, cannot understand what she is trying to reflect on, cannot engage with her research subjects in a meaningful way. But these moments of failure need to be made more present and explicit, and in that moment, while you are being a reflexive individual, you're also showing the limits of that of your knowing position, of your position as a knower and as a producer of knowledge. Another way that Erica Berman highlights is to practice reflexivity rather than through an emotionalized narrative. So this is how I'm feeling. I'm very worried about this particular respondent, or I am fed up with the other person and all that. So rather than practice this kind of confessionalized and emotionalized reflexivity, to consider the institutional location and the positionality of the researcher. In other words, to try and bring out what is it, those aspects of, that make the researcher a producer of knowledge. What institutional relations create the researcher as a producer of knowledge, and the other person that they are researching, or the object of their research, as an object? So she says, to locate reflexive analysis within institutional relationships that precisely interrogate and challenge the constitution of the narrative position of the encounter, rather than explore their identity. So what we want to understand and bring out is what enables us to assume this authority of the producer of knowledge, of the knowing position, rather than talk about how we're feeling and, you know, if we're having a good time or not. So I won't go into the other aspects, but for each one of them, you will find the relevant quote, and as I said, we can have an email communication about them. And I think because we don't have really enough time. And so the practice of reflexivity is fundamental to doing activist research and assuming the commitment of accountability often requires that we interrogate not only our subjects' understandings, but also our own assumptions, the categories with which we approach our subjects, and by extension, our politics. For example, working with and researching migrant women requires us to understand and question the structural and context-specific relations of power we are engaged in and the ways in which we represent both those other women and ourselves. For example, ideas about migrant women's backwardness need to be challenged, and so also do our anti-racist politics need to be challenged by recognizing migrant women's agency and practices of resistance. And this brings us to the issue of intersectionality, which is the next really important, next to reflexivity, intersectionality is the next really important theoretical concept that we need to bring into the picture. So the concept of intersectionality grew out of the feminist conflicts of the 80s between mainstream white middle-class Western feminists who hold the normative feminist position and black lesbian and queer feminists. So while intersectionality is a theoretical concept, a way of understanding social relations of power and the construction of subjectivity, it developed out of political debates, which shows how inseparable theory, ideology, and politics are. So intersectionality theory argues that we are positioned in a web of social relations in complex ways that involve intersecting social differences and axes of power. That means that we are simultaneously occupying different positions and identities as gendered, classed, and racialized subjects. These positions or identities are structurally determined and situated. That is, they are unavoidable, but their manifestation is also context-specific. And, for example, Phoenix and Patinama say, long before the term intersectionality was coined in 1989 by Kimberly Crenshaw, the concept it denotes has been employed in feminist work on how women are simultaneously positioned as women and, for example, as black, working class, lesbian, or colonial subjects. As such, it foregrounds a richer and more complex ontology than approaches that attempt to reduce people to one category at a time. And here we need to think back a little bit, for example, class politics. What is the important aspect? Class identity. All other aspects of subjectivity, all other differences and axes of power are subjective to, let's say, class identity, class consciousness. Intersectionality is saying that this is untenable, that we have to understand subjects as these really complex, as positioned at these intersecting points and relations. And the other thing that these social identities through which we are determined are not inherent. We cannot understand them as essentialized parts of ourselves. They are because we are located somewhere. They are what happens as we are recognized who we are or constructed as particular subjects in relation to other subjects and in relation to other social identities. This means that our subjectivity is, is relationally and discursively produced. It is not inherent. It is produced through the discourses that construct us as subjects, and those discourses and in relation to other subjects. So I am a woman in relation through the discourses that construct me as a woman, through discourses of femininity, but these discourses take on their meaning and their form in relation to other discourses that construct masculinity and in relation to another subject that is recognized as a man, for instance. So that means, this is what relational and discursive, that there is no equivalence between these two, that there is incomprehensibility, incommensurability between these two assumed separate languages and or cultures, right? You don't have to think only of translation in terms of a language. It can also be in terms of a culture. It can also be in terms of any practice. So the need for translation actually highlights how these two cultures cannot be reflected and patterned the one to the other. And that, in that moment, in that, let's say, gap that exists there, the figure of the translator emerges as a very important, let's say, mediator. It's a subject, the translator is sometimes described as a subject in transit, in between. And that is, I consider, one way of conceptualizing the activist researcher as a subject in transit, as a subject who is called upon to negotiate incommensurable differences. They can be political differences, but they can also be cultural or linguistic or differences of practice. And the other thing that's very important in translation, to understand about translation, is that translation is implicated in a way you could say that translation is a nationalist project. Because it is only through translation, through establishing the possibility of translation, that we have national languages standardized and homogenized in order to be translatable. So within a particular territory, out of a multiplicity of languages and dialects and ways of expression and cultural, regional differences, you create a kind of standard homogeneous idiom, which is called the national language, which then can be translated into another national language. So looking at the politics of translation also allows us to address a critique, a kind of anti-nationalist critique as well.
Bueno, nos habla de cómo se puede entender la traducción como metodología.
¿Hay alguna pregunta más? Sí.
Blanca.
Pero la puedes desarrollar después del descanso, ¿eh?
Vale.
La lanzo ya. Si podría explicar un poco más la propuesta de reflexión, como dar cuenta de los límites. Porque me parece que, estoy de acuerdo con la crítica de que no existe como un sujeto reflexivo que sea autoconsciente constantemente de sus emociones, o sea, no somos autoevidentes para nosotras mismas, entonces por eso también me es difícil pensar cómo, si esto es así, o sea, que estoy de acuerdo con esta crítica, cómo puedo dar cuenta de mis límites, o de mis fallos, o de mi estar. O sea, que creo que... bueno, si lo podría desarrollar un poquito, al menos la propuesta de esta autora que no la conocemos.
June, if you can say something more about the letter proposal of the one that you support with Erika,
the institutional location.
No, the other one.